In this little video, I want to talk about a very important historical event for purposes of our course, Bacon's Rebellion of 1676. 1676, so about four generations into this colony, Jamestown, Virginia, 100 years before the signing of the Declaration of Independence. Huge uprising that takes Jamestown, Virginia down to the ground, burns it down completely. So, the origins of this uprising occur with this guy right here. His name is Nathaniel Bacon. And he came over to Virginia around 1676. He joined the House of Burgesses. He is an aristocrat, very elite, landed, young too. He's in his mid-20s. And he notices something right away that he's able to exploit, or at least he attempted to exploit, which was that there was a large class of white English people, poor, disenchanted with their position in life. And they were disenchanted for the position in life due to the reasons that we've talked about. They were indentured servants. And they were promised, obviously, land, tools, a little bit of money, weapons, to get started once they finished out their contract. But typically, they would be given land in this kind of area right here. Let me show you. So if you notice in this area, in the Chesapeake area, this is where the big, rich land plantations would be. This is where indentured servants and slaves alike would go to work. And if you were an indentured servant, if you were lucky enough to finish out your contract, you would get land out in this area, up here, away from water areas and areas near a mountainous region, probably, where the land would be rocky and not as fertile as it would be in a more arid, water approachable area in this region right here. And so these people would have no choice but to go probably further west inland to find some land that they could do something with. And if they went too far west, they would run into these folks right here. These would be the Dog Indians right here, that English settlers and former African indentured servants as well would run into seeking to find other land. And typically these people would not want other people to settle on their land, so skirmishes would happen, conflict would happen. So Dog Indians might kill some white settlers might kill Dog Indians, and pretty soon the House of Burgesses would have a problem on their hand out in the frontier area, this region right here. So out in the frontier areas, this area right here, right? And this would create inherent instability in the region. And that's bad for business. It's bad for property values. It's bad for future investment. And so members of the House of Burgesses in Jamestown would not want that kind of situation happening. So pretty soon, prior to 1676, you had restrictions on where white settlers, English settlers, or I should really use the word English settlers because the word white wouldn't have been used back then. English settlers could go, right, because they want to avoid future skirmishes with these folks right here, the Dog Indians. And so when Nathaniel Bacon comes into this area, he notices this conflict that's brewing. And again, he wants to exploit this for his own personal gain. And so he goes to this guy, Governor Berkeley, and explains to him the situation. So Governor Berkeley, this guy right here, so this fellow right here, Governor Berkeley, explains the situation. Governor Berkeley obviously is well aware of the situation, and he says, I understand, because what Nathaniel Bacon's big problem here is, hold on a second, let me bring both of their images up, is that Nathaniel Bacon would contend that English people shouldn't have to take concessions, shouldn't have to compromise with Native Americans, Dog Indians, right? English people are above Indians here. And Governor Berkeley would say, yes, I agree with you, young man, but you don't understand where you are at. We are surrounded, not just by the Dogue Indians, but by the Powhatan, by a host of other Native American tribes that if they wanted to, they could plan an attack. They've done it before, and they could do it again. So we need to play ball right now. And if the population increases, perhaps, yes, we could take their land in the future. Berkeley, this guy right here, wants nothing to do with this, and he quickly forms a militia of this discontented people. And he goes after the Dogue Indians and some other tribes as well, making war on the people. When Governor Berkeley, when this guy finds out about it, he's furious. This guy, how he sees it is Nathaniel Bacon is possibly completely destabilizing this entire region, and this cannot be tolerated. So he sends out a militia to confront Nathaniel Bacon's army. And what is peculiar about Nathaniel Bacon's army is that it is made up of both poor English people, white folks, and poor African people, right? Black people. And this would have been a normal occurrence. This would have been expected at this time. This wouldn't have been shocking. But something does get exposed here. You notice right here, in a depiction of Nathaniel Bacon's rebellion right here, you can tell that these are African-descended people fighting in this rebellion here. Again, this would not have been a surprise, but what gets exposed here is that we do not have a group of people that are viewing each other racially. The members of Bacon's army were poor. That's what they had in common. And it exposed a greater reality that that members of the House of Burgesses were certainly aware of. But it had come, like so many things that humans do, they put things off to the last moment until there is a crisis. And this indeed was a crisis. Jamestown was burnt to the ground. Governor Berkeley narrowly escapes with his life. For all extensive purposes, the rebellion was successful, except Nathaniel Bacon contracts dysentery and dies shortly thereafter. The army was rounded up by the British Navy, and its ringleaders were summarily arrested and then executed, and so it was suppressed. But what this What this made clear to members of the House of Burgesses and to the Parliament in London is that what was created in Jamestown could not be duplicated in other colonies, and it needed to be redirected within Jamestown, Virginia, and throughout Virginia. And that is, they had created a powder keg of a community of people that were class-oriented. So white and black people, for the first 3 to 4 generations in Virginia, they slept together, they ate together, they had families together, they got drunk together, they ate together. They saw each other as the same people with the same problems and common interests and common enemies. And so what begins to happen after Bacon's Rebellion is that previous laws that were on the books that were largely ignored, that differentiated race, would be now enforced. And other laws that would differentiate race would be introduced and enforced. And so it becomes illegal for white and black people to marry. It becomes illegal, even in common law. It had always been considered illegal, but even in common law, it would become illegal. It would be illegal to have children together. It would be illegal for white and black people to live together. Separate punishments would be enforced. So if a white person was to run away as an indentured servant, he might just get 1 or 2 years. If a black indentured servant or slave was to run away, he would become a slave for life. This is still when slavery is in transition here, and you have
people aren't clear of how long should a person be a slave. Well, by the time 1676 rolls around, it becomes quite clear who is going to be a slave and how long they are going to be a slave. To be a slave means to be black, and to be a slave means to be a slave for life. At first, these laws would have been resented by the lower classes of people. But given another generation, by the 1700s, by the time you get to the early 1700s, both poor, middle class, and rich English people, white people, now we can begin using that term, white people, by the time we get to the 1700s, understand themselves to be biologically superior. Biologically superior, since that's what the law reflects. And what's probably first understood is that the law was a cynically imposed law by a bunch of rich landed elite folks who were just trying to entrench their power. But give it 25 years later, and a new generation of people are born into this, obviously the law is reflecting a natural law, that white people are superior. And if you're poor and you're white, your life can be dismal, it could be discouraging, but at least you have your white skin, and that white skin gives you the possibility that if you work hard enough, maybe one year you could get slaves. And if you work even harder, maybe you can get more land. And maybe if you work really hard, you could be like that rich white plantation owner who's got the good life. You just have to work a little bit harder, and luck has to get on your side, right? Bacon's Rebellion, hugely significant event that, in tandem with a lot of other events like the Stono Rebellion and with changes in the economy, that is, indentured servants becoming more expensive because there's less of them, and the slave trade becoming more accessible to the English colonists. In tandem with all of that, Bacon's Rebellion also is a determining factor of institutionalizing not only slavery in British America, because again, it's a gradual thing, and at first the British colonists were dead set against having slaves, but it's also a mechanism that creates the concept that we're very, very much familiar with today, race. That is, white versus black, black versus white. That conflict that definitely exists today and establishes this thing called white identity and white supremacy throughout colonial America and all through American history to this very second, as we see manifest through images of Trayvon Martin and what's going on in Ferguson. You hear lots of people, whether one agrees with it or not, looking at the legacy of white supremacy in this country and how it still manifests today. Okay, so what I have to conclude this little lecture on Bacon's Rebellion is a clip on a gentleman named Anthony Johnson, who was one of the original slaves brought on the Dutch ship to Jamestown in 1619. He survives the Powhatan attack in 1623 that almost wiped out Jamestown. And he grows to prominence. He becomes a rich landowner. He is well respected within the community, and he lives a very prosperous life. But within his lifetime, as he becomes older, he gets to see the establishment of white supremacy and the degradation of anybody who had African descent, including his children, into a permanent second-class citizenship. So watch the story. The whole video is available in the notes, and I think I might even put it within the lecture page as well, so you can watch the whole video. We'll probably watch it in class as well. But yeah, take a look at this, and we'll talk more about it later.
The prosperity that began in 1619 and the dream of a new Eden, of people peacefully coexisting under English law, was fiercely threatened in March 1619. 1622. On Good Friday, some 30 nations of the Powhatan Confederacy, angered by English violation of land treaties, attacked without warning and attempted to drive the English back into the sea. Along the James River, the Indians killed 350 colonists. On the Bennett plantation alone, 52 people died. Among the 12 who survived was a man named Antonio.
Here's an individual that arrives as one of the first African Americans in the history of what became the United States. He does what almost no one in early Virginia managed to do, and that is live. Everyone that's dying of disease, violence, and since he's lucky.
He had been brought to the colony the year before to work tobacco along the James River. His name appeared in the 1625 Virginia census as Antonio, a Negro. He was listed as a servant.
He comes to Virginia, finds a society that is just developing. He's getting in on the ground floor, as it were. I don't know if he was able to immediately envision that there would be opportunities for him here that weren't available elsewhere. I don't know that anyone could have foretold that.
When Antonio arrived, the laws of Virginia did not as yet define racial slavery. They governed only the status of servants. At some point, Antonio changed his name to Anthony Johnson and married a Negro servant named Mary from a neighboring plantation. She bore him four children. By 1640, it is clear Anthony and Mary were no longer servants. They had acquired their own modest estate on Virginia's eastern shore.
As Johnson prospered, as he obtained land and cattle, he also acquired dependent laborers. What made all of this society go was property. Your identity in the society was determined rather obviously by the amount of land, the amount of labor that you owned.
Anthony Johnson was enjoying privileges belonging to a free Englishman. He claimed five workers as head rights and expanded his property to 250 acres along the Pongateek Creek. At least some of his workers were white. By 1650, Anthony was one of 400 black people in Virginia out of a population of almost 19,000 settlers. In Northampton County, where Johnson lived, nearly 20 African men and women were free, and 13 owned their own homes.
As Anthony Johnson is accumulating property, it seems as though his situation is secure. You get a sense of this individual, this black man, being treated like any white planter, and his wife and daughters being treated like the wife of a planter.
At an early moment, when men and women were sorting themselves out, when the rules, the etiquette of race, labor, were not so clear, at this moment, in one county in Virginia, it was not foreordained that race relations would become what they did become.
In 1640, the year Anthony Johnson purchased his first piece of land, three servants had run away from a Virginia plantation and headed for Maryland. Captured and returned to their owner, they were tried for breaking their contract.
The said three servants shall receive the punishment of whipping and have 30 stripes apiece. One called Victor, a Dutchman, the other a Scotchman called James Gregory, shall first serve out their times according to their indentures, in one whole year apiece after, and after that to serve the colony for three whole years apiece. The third, being a Negro named John Punch, shall serve his said master or his assigns for the time of his natural life. Jamestown Court Recorder.
the time of his natural life. According to all the legal records that survive, no white servant in America ever received such a sentence.
So what begins to happen in the 1640s is that those who are controlling the Virginia colony say to themselves, the fluidity that we've seen in the past, the fluidity that has allowed an Anthony Johnson to serve less than a life term, to acquire his own piece of ground, to develop a free status, is not something that we want to project as going further in the future. We want to close down that opportunity. We want to begin to show some distinctions.
The English definition of who could be enslaved began to shift from non-Christian to non-white. For Anthony and other Africans in America, the idea of an equal chance in the colonies was now under attack. In 1641, Massachusetts became the first colony on the British American mainland to recognize slavery as a legal institution. Connecticut followed in 1650, Maryland in 1663, New York and New Jersey in 1664. Virginia legally recognized slavery in 1661, and a year later, a Virginia court decided that all children born in the colony would be free or slave according to the condition of the mother. In Virginia, slavery would be defined by race and perpetuated through heredity.
Perhaps in the middle of the 17th century, if you were one of several thousand Africans living in Virginia, you certainly knew that your children would be free. You might have that expectation. And to suddenly find themselves involved in lifelong servitude and then to realize that in fact their children might inherit the same status, that was a terrible blow. That was a terrible transformation. The problem they face is not only a decreasing supply of indentured servants, but they face this increasing problem of what to do with all these indentured servants once they live out their term. And a lot of them were surviving. They had to be given land. They had to be given their freedom dues. And one of those dues included even guns. And there was a lot of unrest in Virginia.
In 1661, servants rebelled in York County. 2 years later, Gloucester County authorities foiled a plot by 9 servants to steal arms and ammunition and march on the seat of colonial government. In 1676, the unrest in Virginia exploded into civil war. An army of 500, free men, servants, and slaves, rebelled against the colonial establishment's restriction on available lands. They attacked peaceful Indians, ransacked property, and burned Jamestown, sending the governor into hiding.
This disorder that the indentured servant system had created made racial slavery to Southern slaveholders much more attractive, because what were black slaves now? Well, they were a permanent, dependent labor force who could be defined as a people set apart. They were racially set apart. They were outsiders. They were strangers. And in many ways, throughout the world, with a couple possible exceptions, slavery has taken root especially well when the people who are enslaved are defined as strangers, as outsiders, and can therefore be put into an inheritable, permanent the status of slavery. I understand there are some slave ships expected into York River now every day.